This video is brought to you by QuizTones, my all-time favorite app for learning frequencies. Today I am very excited because we have one of my really good friends, Chris Jakob, coming in to listen to a mix I did of his song. He's an electronic artist and I have a surprise for him. He just thinks that I mixed the song and he's gonna listen to a stereo mix, but I'm actually finishing up an Atmos mix this morning. He has no idea. We haven't talked about Atmos. He has never heard his music in immersive audio.
Bro, you mixed it in Atmos?
Yeah.
I was tearing up, but I was like, I can't cry right now. Oh my God.
I thought it would just be like a fun little gift for him to kind of experience. So excited about it. I'm so excited to show him. Now I just got to figure out where I'm going to hide the cameras to get his like raw reaction. And don't worry, I'm going to tell him after. But if we do get a reaction that's not that excited, I'm still going to show it. So we'll see what happens. Before I hide the cameras, the first thing I have to do is make this session look like it's just a stereo file. All right, so we are going to hide all these. Perfect. Now we gotta figure out where to hide these cameras. Okay, GoPro. Okay, what if I stick it just behind Yoda? Yoda is the camera protector. I think with the lights down low, you're not gonna be able to see it. I think it's gonna be perfect. Now you, where are you going? I honestly think the best thing to do is just to stick it in this corner over here and just tell them that after we're gonna do some filming. So I just have the cameras out of the way. Let's do that. It'll be fine. All right, we're good to go. Sorry, the lighting is terrible. It'll be worth it for his reaction. Now we just wait for him to show up, I guess.
Are you gonna film the reaction or are we gonna film
it? We'll film it after.
After,
yeah.
Okay.
All right. You ready?
Yes.
How many hours?
Not that many, honestly, because it was overall, like the movement was really good. I told you that before. Mm-hmm. Like the movement was super good and it flowed really well.
All I know is that I can't believe that this is real.
Yeah.
All right.
You ready?
Yeah.
Actually, you should push the play right there.
There's movement that I didn't control. You did that?
That was the Atmos, dude.
Bro, you mixed it in Atmos?
Yeah.
That's what it is, bro.
Let me put the screen to Atmos so you can see what's going on.
Hold on. Bro, because I was like, there's so much space. It was like blowing my mind.
I know.
And I was tearing up, but I was like, I can't cry right now. Oh my God.
I just hit all the tracks so that you wouldn't see anything. So you would just think that it's that, but it's
well, not. At first I was like, how did you do that in stereo? That's what I was thinking.
Totally.
In my mind I was like, how did you get it up here? How is it right here right now? How did it go up?
Dude, just watch that screen.
Bro,
it's crazy, huh?
So sick. God, bro.
Isn't that cool?
That is so much better than I... That's, like, way better than I could have even imagined.
Oh, yeah.
Dude, I think anybody who listens to that in AirPods or audio is going to freaking lose their mind.
Oh, yeah, they are.
As soon as the bass came in, though, in the beginning, I was just blown away by the space.
As many tutorials as I watch and as many techniques as I watch, and whenever I, like, apply it myself, it's still never... is there until today. Nothing would make me happier than this song taking off and then just getting like so many electronic producers who want the analog gear, because that's like a element that's missing. Oh my God, dude, I can't believe how good it sounds. I just can't believe. through the whole song the first time you played it, all I could think about was how like this is what it was meant to be. How I wanted it to sound. I just couldn't get it to sound like that.
That's awesome, dude. I love that.
And then I got distracted with the...
Oh, totally.
And then I was like...
It's like, what is happening?
Is this Dolby? How did he do that? In my mind, I was like, what plugin is that?
Is that
Bauer Motion?
Yeah.
Did Bauer Motion just get that crazy?
You can do that, but a lot of times you don't have to.
What's that?
Oh, sorry, dude. I've been recording this whole thing. I was going to ask you about
it. No, that's totally fine.
Because I was going to be like, guess what, dude?
Recorded everything. In my mind, I was like, this is so good. And then I was like, you should turn on the camera. This conversation's so good. And then we got so lost in the conversation, I forgot about this even being a YouTube video.
Yeah.
That's crazy. What's up, world? That's sick.
Don't Josh is the freaking best dude ever.
I don't even know how to repay you in gratitude, bro.
You do every day, man.
That was such a cool experience. One of my favorite things in the world is bringing an artist, especially if it's a friend, into the studio and let them listen to their song with these speakers, especially when we're talking about Atmos. That's just a whole nother level. I feel like Atmos is this thing right now that's so hard to comprehend for so many people. So whenever they get to hear their music in that way and they haven't even really heard that before in general, it's really, really fun. And it becomes fun to talk about, like, what's the potential, like, where can we go from here in terms of immersive audio. Such a good guy, Chris Jakob, super good friend of mine, very, very, very talented artist, musician. He's one of my favorite people in the world, so for me to work with someone like that is really special. So I appreciate him, appreciate you, man. Now that you've heard his perspective, I'm going to play you sort of just a before and after of kind of his rough mix versus my mix. We'll go back and forth between the two, and then I'm going to break down each of these stems so you can kind of see the process of what I did and why I did it and all that stuff. So there's a pretty big difference in terms of depth, in terms of openness, especially in the low end. The kick is coming through a lot more whenever all the big music and the big musical pieces come through. The majority of this track was just stems mastering. When I heard the full mix that he did, I was like, oh, wow, this actually sounds really good. I think we can get away with just having the kick and snare and hi-hats and, you know, all the independent stuff instead of every single individual channel. It was really nice to have a good starting place where the mix already sounded really good, and I honestly didn't focus very much on volume or movement at all, because all that was really solid. So let's break it down. Let's start with the kick. Really, the only thing I did on the kick is add a touch of high end at 8K. I don't know what the dB value is. It's probably around like 1.5 to 2 dB. I just needed a tiny, tiny bit more top end on the kick overall, compared especially to the reference tracks that he sent me. But that's it. The kick I didn't change besides that. I just left it. Snare drum, I inserted my TubeTech PE1C. It's just an EQ. The snare overall to me was just a little bit thin. It wasn't making you like really feel the beat and just have that impact. So I put it through a tube equalizer basically. And at 100 hertz, I boosted around 3 dB. It's subtle, but it makes such a big difference. So I'm gonna play real quick. This is just raw snare drum. TubeTech. You can really hear it in the track, so let's turn it off. And here's on. Pretty big difference. The only thing I changed other than that in the snare was the first time the snare comes in, I just brought it down a couple dB. After bringing up that low end, it just needed to be lower in the quieter sections. But once all the music comes in, it fit the part perfectly. So now the hi-hats. On the hi-hats, all I did was add a tiny, tiny bit of top end on the GEQ of the SSL. I'll show you a little before and after of that. So here's hi-hats, no EQ. with EQ. Tiny, tiny adjustment. I didn't touch those at all in the beginning. And then I got his reference tracks, which I had him send me three tracks that he really liked the mix of and the overall sound of that were in the genre that he was trying to do. And I noticed in all of the mixes, the hi-hats, there's a lot of high end and they were shimmery, but not too much. And there was almost no low end. Luckily, I didn't have to carve out any low end. Once I raised those highs, the apparent volume kind of came up. So I brought that down and then the low end didn't even bother me at all in the track. So it worked out. Then we have what he calls transients, which I'll play you a little bit of those. So it's just cymbals, all stuff like that. I use this plugin called Gulfoss. It's kind of like a large multi-band dynamic EQ. I have it on a low percentage, this bias all at 100%. You can kind of see what it's doing here. So if I turn this off, you almost want to squint because the high end is sort of taking over. And I totally could have EQ'd this out, but there was moments where I really wanted that dependent on what the instrument was. So Gulfoss does such a good job of when it's too loud, it lowers it down. And whenever it's just right, it doesn't change it at all, which is really, really nice. All right, so we're gonna go to the bass. So the only thing I did on the bass, we'll play a little bit of that. So all I did was add a sidechain compressor here. So on my kick drum, I'm sending out a pre-fader bus send that's going to the sidechain of this compressor here. I have this actually going to a few different bass elements or stuff that had low end because I had trouble getting the kick to really poke through whenever the song gets huge and massive. So I've got the melody bass, I've got lead two, saw pad, and the main melody that all have this compressor on it that's sidechained with the kick. So this is no compression on this section here. All right, and then this is with these compressors on. You can hear the kick just pokes out just a little bit. Nothing complicated. Super fast attack, super fast release. It works just fine. Okay, so the synth here. So this is like the real bass to me of the track. And I actually wanted some more depth to this, so I ran it into my TubeTex. It's a stereo stem. I ran it into my TubeTex CL1B compressor. It's not actually compressing. I just wanted that tube grit sound, so I added a tiny bit of gain to it. Oh, and then I ran it to my Manly Massive Passive. I have a high pass on 22 hertz, just kind of cleaned up that super sub low range. And then at 1.2K and above, I have a shelf and I'm boosting like 6 dB, I think. Unfortunately, I don't have the before and after because I printed it down and then my Massive Passive has an issue to where it doesn't work unless I bypass the right side. So I can't show you the before and after, but this is what it sounds like with all the beef in it. It just sounds great. All right, so then we have lead one. I just have a little bit of EQ. It was really this lead one and this main melody together were creating some conflicting frequencies that wasn't making the melody of the song come through like it does in the slower sections of the song. So this is the main lead. And then you've got this main melody. So there's some similar notes in there and they were just conflicting with each other. Very subtle. Nothing that really changes too much on that one. Then we've got lead two. The only thing that's on this one is that sidechain compressor. We've got our saw pad, the same thing. It's got the sidechain compressor from the kick drum and then some annoying frequencies and low end that were just muddying things up. Thank you. very simple. Again, nothing too crazy. Okay, my favorite thing is this pad down here. Pad layer. No inserts, no EQ. I really like the way this sounded. And on this one, I could see what he was doing with the reverb that's in there, but the depth wasn't totally there. It wasn't obvious. So I added the Bracasti preset Shimmering Sky with like a ridiculous 8-second reverb time, but it worked. Turning it off. It, like, all the life goes away whenever it's off. All right, then we've got the effects, which are really fun. Yeah, just these random. I've got a little bit of EQ right here from just a note that came through. And then I have them actually going to my Chandler Limited TG 12-411s, I think they're called. It's basically a channel strip preamp with an EQ, and I love the EQ so much. I just added a bunch of high end to that just to really make it punch out. It's a huge difference, especially when you hear this part. This is no EQ. EQ. Pretty cool. All right, then we have the main lead line. So I have the same exact, whatever you call it, and then just a tiny little annoying frequency there. But that's pretty much it. This track was very well done. The only other thing I have is on my master bus, I'm going to a Shadow Hills mastering compressor. It's my favorite compressor of all time. You know this if you watch this channel. Then it's going to a Chandler Limited curve bender, a little bit of low end, a tiny bit of high end at 16K, just a little boost, make it really nice. I'm using the vintage drive on the console, the SSL Fusion, super good, and a little bit of the space stereo image module, and then just a little bit of mastering EQ, limiting, nothing too crazy. The song itself sounded so good, so it worked really well. Thank you so much for watching this video. I really hope you like it. I hope you enjoyed it, and yeah, give some love to Chris Jakob. I will link him down below. Go listen to some of his music. It's good stuff. I will see you next week. Peace.